So it's always really dangerous to ask me to come and speak about drug pricing because it's my favorite thing, as everybody at Kaiser will tell you. And I also have a propensity to speak at incredible length on this subject. But we only have half an hour today for me to give you the buyer's perspective on prescription drugs. So my team actually put together a few slides in an effort to try to contain me to 30 minutes of actual speaking. But the reason that this is such a matter of interest to me is it was really the first subject that I was able to work on after I had graduated from law school. When I started practicing here in Washington in 1991, the very first issue I started working on in private practice on behalf of hospital group purchasing organizations was prescription drug pricing and the new regulation of pricing that was coming to the fore. So it was that that led me to Kaiser. It was that that led me to do the work that I was able to do at Kaiser over time. And so I'm actually grateful that this issue exists. It's sort of a motivator for me. It's something that I love to talk about, and I'm very worried about that. So I'm going to ask my colleague, Ted Etan, who's one of our hosts here at the Center for Total Health, a wonderful guy. By the way, if you want to follow anybody on Twitter just to get a combination of fun and health at the same time, follow Ted on Twitter. But I learned in reading on his Twitter feed the other day that there's something called a hug timer. And so I'm going to give Ted license if I go over my time to deploy the hug timer. Ted, I assume it has something to do with I love you and it's time for you to stop talking now. Is that a good way to describe the hug timer? Okay, excellent. And knowing the economists and physicians we have presenting today, on their behalf, I will also give you license to deploy it for them as well. But that's just for fun. Okay, do we have a clicker for slides? We do, clicker for slides. All right, so now I'm not an economist, I'm not a doctor, I work for Kaiser Permanente, I'm not a doctor, and I was a history major. But for almost 25 years, I've worked on the issue of drug pricing, and I'm one of the people who speaks a lot about drug pricing from the perspective of people who have to buy drugs. My job over much of that time that I've been working at Kaiser was to be the policy advisor and lawyer for the folks who are actually working with the pharmaceutical industry and buying drugs. And it's been super instructive in understanding how this market works. Unfortunately, I still only have a history major's understanding of economics. So I will try to do, I will try to describe what the, you know, how I understand a market is supposed to work, talk a little bit about the pharmaceutical market, talk about how I think the prescription drug market works, and then we can talk about some of the reasons why and a little bit of history about that. So a history major would say the way a market is supposed to work, and fortunately we have Professor Reinhardt and, you know, Professor Nichols and others who will sit here and explain, this is why you don't want history majors explaining economics to people. I would say, sellers sell for as much as they can. That's what is supposed to happen in a market. Buyers buy for as little as they can, trying to do whatever they can to avoid paying what the sellers want them to pay. Now, I think there are words in economics that are used to describe this. I think it translates down to price elasticity in a market, which is the relative ability of a seller to enforce the price they want to sell at, and the relative ability of the buyer to basically say no. And that really is a crucial thing, is this question about saying no and having an alternative and being able to buy something else. And then you hope all of this takes place in a marketplace that through a process of competition, the prices will be set in the end based on the, if you think about it as a Venn diagram, somewhere there's a common it's okay for the buyer and a common it's okay for the seller, and the price hopefully will wind up someplace in that Venn diagram common area, whatever you economists call that. And then the real issue is that that whole process of competition has to be protected by law to ensure that you don't that you don't have anti-competitive conduct going on, whether that's explicit conspiracy to avoid actually competing, or just the natural development of monopolies, you know, the purchasing, the seller having monopoly power or monopsonies, where a buyer becomes too strong and can basically enforce its will on a purchaser. So that is, I had, you know, my one or two classes of economics in college, and that's sort of what I learned and all of that. But I think that's sort of how it works. So it's important to understand the nature of the prescription drug market. And actually, there's been a revolutionary change in the prescription drug market since I started looking at this thing in the United States back in 1990. Back in 1990, it was a very, very different marketplace. The majority, almost two-thirds of all drug spending back in 1990 came out of individuals' pockets. So that was basically the number of dollars that came out of an individual who was using a prescription drug. Almost two-thirds of it came out of their pocket. 26% of that money was actually covered by insurance. Prescription drug benefits in the 1990s were actually not that common. We at Kaiser had them pretty extensively. It was a traditional HMO benefit, but it wasn't that common in the rest of the market. Medicaid represented about 11% of the total market, and there wasn't a whole bunch of anything else. And then what you see here through the 90s was a radical and rapid growth of third-party coverage of prescription drugs. This was the era in which the PBMs really grew, where other health insurers started covering prescription drug benefits, employer coverage of drug benefits became much more common. And so you see this grew over time to a point where almost two-thirds of costs were paid for by private insurers, third-party payers, PBMs, employers, folks like that. That's where the money was really coming from. And only 20% of the money was actually coming out of people's pockets. And at the same time, the Medicaid program stayed sort of roughly representing about the same amount. The next big change in coverage happened in 2006, when in 2003, the Part D program was designed, and then it was deployed in 2006. So you added Medicare coverage. That took up some of the third-party coverage, but again, it squeezed down more the amount of money that was coming out of individuals' pockets. And now we're in a situation where it sits now. So I think it's important to understand what the prescription drug marketplace actually looks like from the demand side in terms of where the money is coming from. Because to understand what's been happening over time, you need to understand that nature of that change. So the way I translate how the pharmaceutical market works is basically, and this is all appropriate and systematic, we have a system that's used intellectual property rights and other market exclusivity rights in order to incent manufacturers to develop new drugs. It's an innovation incentive. This is true in pharmaceuticals. It's true in other industries. The idea of protecting intellectual property in order to incent innovation is really critical. And as you'll see as we talk throughout the course of the day, the real question that we have here isn't, is it appropriate to protect intellectual property? It's a question of, when is it too much? When is it being abused? When is it out of balance? When does it stop serving social purposes and social needs? And that's an ultimate question that we need to ask. As I was saying before, buyers in the pharmaceutical market are divided up into a series of different players. You've got the people who actually take the drugs, the patients and consumers who take the drugs. You have the people who decide what drug those people are going to take. Those are physicians and other prescribers. You have a distribution channel that ends with retail pharmacies typically, although some organizations like ours actually also dispense the drugs directly, but a distribution chain that doesn't have much influence over how much drugs will cost from a buyer's perspective. Even though they're buying drugs in one respect, they're not making choices about which drugs will ultimately be sold in the end. So it fractures that aspect of the purchasing side. And then payers, the third-party payers, whether it's public programs or private programs, and those are ultimately the players who have the strongest stake in making sure that there is a competitive market, that they are the ones that are ultimately absorbing the cost, and they have the stake. And that's why PBMs have grown up to represent health insurance organizations and other employer third-party payers to try to manage the cost of prescription drugs. That's basically how the system works. Unfortunately, for almost three decades now, policy has systematically undermined the bargaining power of folks on the purchasing side. And that's what I want to talk a little bit about today, and that's why I titled this, "The Swing Against the Tide in the Agenda." Certainly is how it's felt working in this area for 25 years, but it's a little history of drug pricing over the past 25 years or so to talk about what's been going on. So, this is, I think, the conversation that will be helpful to hear from the economists and others later in the day to try to start a dialogue about what kinds of policy changes do we think we need to explore. So you know, there's a couple of other slides in here which we don't have to talk too much about. Just this is my proof slide. We're all here because we've recognized that the problem is back. So we can talk about that some more. I don't need to go into too much depth about that. This is another slide that says, oh my goodness, the problem is back. Prices are escalating very rapidly, particularly driven by specialty drugs. That's what this says. And we'll have more discussion about that as the day goes on. But I want to talk a little bit about how we got here in the end. And I'm hoping that these slides will work properly. So here's a chart of total drug spending over time. And you can see that it has inflated, and it's inflated in excess of substantially in excess of even healthcare spending generally, but also the economy as a whole. So I want to talk a little bit about things that have been going on that I think have been driving this escalation in drug costs. So the first thing that I would talk about was the Medicare Catastrophic Coverage Act debacle in 1988 and 1989. What transpired there was Congress did enact a new Medicare drug benefit. It was somewhat ill-designed. It was designed as a catastrophic benefit where everybody in Medicare would have to pay into this benefit, and only something like 16% of Medicare beneficiaries would ever get anything out of the drug benefit. This was a terrifying event for the pharmaceutical industry because they were looking at it and they realized suddenly the government is going to have a huge stake in figuring out how drugs are priced, particularly as part of the Medicare program, and they'd seen what had happened in the rest of the healthcare system about hospitals and physician payments, and they said, oh my goodness, we're worried about this. So they really did lead a campaign to repeal the Medicare Catastrophic Act, I think largely to get rid of the drug benefit, and it succeeded. And I think that the process of advocacy awakened the drug industry in two ways. One, to understand that their franchise could be threatened if it became substantially subsumed by a purchaser who was quite aggressive, like the Medicare program. They also realized that there were advocacy tools that they could deploy in policy to drive their interests very effectively. It was really the first intensive use of so-called AstroTurf campaigns, where you would have a company calling individuals, telling them on the phone, this is a terrible thing that's happening. Do you want me to patch you through to your congressperson? And they created a zillion calls. And then we all remember that, you know, Congressman Rostenkowski had people climbing on his car and stuff, and they repealed the law. Okay, so that was fun. I think the thing that has had the most significant and negative impact on the pharmaceutical marketplace happened in Ober 90, which was the establishment of the Medicaid drug rebate program. And fundamentally, this was a real breakpoint, and of course, it's been a full employment act for me because for the subsequent 25 years, I've been trying to get this changed. Unsuccessfully, all of you who I have lobbied will, you know, report. But it's really important to understand what happened here. You know, prior to 1990, organizations that did provide prescription drug coverage and did provide quite a lot of pharmaceutical therapy did have the ability to go to the drug manufacturers, and if there were two or three products that were roughly similar to each other, and you had a good organization in which the prescribers were willing to say, if drugs A, B, and C work effectively the same, we are all willing to use drug A or drug B or drug C, and our organization could then go to the market and say, hey, drug companies A, B, and C, we think we can use any one of these three drugs. And even if it was a pretty high-priced drug, they would compete on each other, would compete with each other on price, and we would be able to negotiate very, very deep discounts. In fact, prior to 1990, it was not at all uncommon for an organization like Kaiser or Group Health, or for that matter, the Veterans Administration or other organizations that were integrated and did a good job of managing pharmaceutical therapy, they could go to market and get discounts of 50, 60, 70, 80%, sometimes even 90%, because it was a competitive marketplace and you could actually go and negotiate on that basis. Now, there were some people who were not happy about the fact that some organizations were actually able to negotiate prices like that, principally the people who were having to give the discounts to get that business, some of the manufacturers who had a philosophy that we don't really want to be discounting. We want to be selling the same drug for the same price to everybody who buys it. So they were being undercut on price. They were concerned about that. Another group of people who were concerned about it were the people who were not getting those discounts. So the retail pharmacy community was very concerned that others were really the distribution chain would change in a way that was frankly more efficient. This was about mail order pharmacies having building systems to encourage shifting from one drug to another drug. It was organizations like ours, it was some others. They didn't like that either. And of course, at the time, the Medicaid program was being disadvantaged because it was not well organized. It was simply paying for the drugs that were being prescribed, and the prices, they were paying the full price. So that combination of concerns came together and established the Medicaid rebate program. And there's nothing wrong about Medicaid getting rebates or having statutory discounts for a public program or anything like that. The problem with the law was the way they designed how those rebates would be offered. And what they did was they created a most favored nation provision for the Medicaid program that was essentially, if Kaiser, for example, is getting a 70% discount on a particular drug, then the manufacturer also has to give that same discount to the Medicaid program. Some people say, well, that seems fair. That's okay. We don't want Medicaid to have to pay more than anybody else. Unfortunately, the economists will tell us later in words that actually make sense other than my practical words of what happened was all our discounts went away. And that was actually very well established by people who are studying it afterwards, that those very deep discounts that were being offered where there was a competitive situation were no longer offered. And in practice, what I can tell you is over the years, in advising hospital group purchasing organizations, for a long time advising the Kaiser purchasing people, what you experience with the drug manufacturers when you're trying to negotiate on price with them is once you get to something that looks like the, once you get to what is the minimum rebate. So it started out 15% was the minimum rebate for Medicaid. And then if somebody had a deeper discount, they got that instead. Once you hit that, the manufacturer would start to resist because they knew if even though Kaiser was say 2% of the market or Group Health is a small fraction of the market or some other purchaser, even the VA, which was a little bit bigger, what was happening was they're like, well, we're not gonna give you any more discount because if we do that, we have to give the same discount to Medicaid. And rather than giving it to Medicaid, they did the economically rational thing, was to say, well, we're just not gonna discount. So in practice, what's happened is the Medicaid best price rebate program has operated as a floor on drug prices, that well-organized purchasers no longer have the incentive to get better organized, and they're not able to drive discounts down lower, as low as they would if there was a truly market competitive situation. So that's the thing that, you know, has been central to this. The impact of it has expanded. I don't have this on there, but subsequent to OBRA, everybody recognized, wow, suddenly the VA's discounts all went away too. So a couple years later, Congress passed a separate law giving the VA its own discount program and exempting it from this best price problem. Another year long, they created another program that established the federal 340B program and said, okay, the public hospitals are out of this as well. Not only are we gonna get them out of this, we're gonna give them the advantage of the Medicaid best price as well, further enhancing the strength of the most favored nation provision. So for 25 years, the pharmaceutical marketplace has operated under circumstances in which even if you're a very sensible purchaser and organizing yourself as well as you can to use market forces to negotiate prices lower, you can't do it. So that's the basic story of OBRA 90, and you can see why I can talk about this for hours on end. So there were other things that happened during this period. I was fascinated in 1995 when industrial patents were extended from 17 years to 20 years. The only thing that was disturbing about this, other than there was never a debate about whether it should be 17 years or 20 years in Congress, there didn't have to be a debate because the United States government negotiated this into a trade agreement and then was forced to adopt it without debate into 20-year extension of patents. And so I raise this because we have similar situation going on now with the negotiation of the Trans-Pacific Partnership where there are issues being negotiated around protection, market exclusivity protection in the pharmaceutical marketplace that are being negotiated there that nobody really knows what's going on. I've read articles in Politico and said there are things going on there. But if those things wind up in the final agreement, they're going to wind up having to be adopted by Congress without any kind of specific discussion about that. Now, I'm not taking sides on trade agreements. I'm just suggesting that when you want to make big policy changes, like, for example, establish new market exclusivity for pharmaceuticals, Congress ought to have the ability to have that discussion about whether that should happen, rather than having it presented as a fait accompli and then adopted as a whole. So that's something that happened first in my consciousness then. I'm sure it happened before that, but it's another issue that's kind of back again that's worth thinking about. In 1997, another thing happened that further impaired the ability of organizations to manage prescription drug costs and prescription drug utilization, and that was when the FDA changed its rules on consumer advertising and for the first time permitted direct-to-consumer television advertising. I actually had a joke with some of my colleagues at the time where, because there's such a mismatch between pharmaceutical economics and media economics, that I did a little thought experiment and I said, at the time the pharmaceutical industry was about a $200 billion industry and they put about 10%, they claim there's about, it was something like 30% of their costs in the industry were marketing, and about 10% of those were essentially direct to consumer. So I was thinking, well, if they didn't do anything different and they deployed that direct-to-consumer money the same way, it was a couple $1 billion, and I put that next to what was the cost of all the television advertising at prime time on the major networks, and it became quite clear that without breaking a sweat, the pharmaceutical industry could pretty much buy up all of the television advertising that was going on prime time. And so I said this as a joke at the time with one of my colleagues, but if any of you still watch television and watch commercials, you can see I was only half right. I think they only bought half of the ads on TV. So that's another thing. But that does have an impact on the ability of organizations to drive rational drug use. It does take, if you remember, that the majority of people in the country have pretty robust drug coverage. So they're insulated from the ultimate prices of the drugs because the insurer is going to pick that up. But they are being pressed to ask for the more expensive therapies. So that's something that's been going on as well. 2006 was a huge huge and really a very good thing, was the expansion of coverage in the Medicare program. A couple of things that happened there, though, were of concern. One, it was really the first time that there was quite intensive pharmaceutical formulary regulation over organizations that were trying to manage formularies. And so they Congress imposed you have to have two drugs in every class test about formularies for plans in the Part D program, which set the baseline for what was expected of formularies in the marketplace. And they added additional restrictions, such as there are about six types of drugs that you have to have every drug in class, which further impairs the ability to negotiate on price. In addition, because Part D was set up as a private delivered program through private organizations, one of the things that had to be negotiated in order to have the pharmaceutical industry, I mean, the pharmaceutical industry learned a lot in 1988, and many of those lessons were executed on in 2006. One was, and everybody learned a lot in that, one lesson was you've got to have coverage up front and not just catastrophic coverage, which is why we've wound up with this crazy donut hole design in the Medicare Part D program. But another one was the pharmaceutical industry negotiated into the final legislation the so-called non-interference clause, which is to say that the government cannot, Medicare cannot get involved in negotiating on the costs of drugs. That is left entirely up to the private plans and, you know, all the other things that are going on in the marketplace here. There's another thing that's been going on over time at the state level, which is really important to focus on, and that is various laws to require certain types of designs or prohibit certain types of designs in prescription drug benefits that are offered in the commercial market. One of those has been an oral chemotherapy parity law that's been rolling around many of the states, and now it's in place in 34 states in DC. And what this law says is if there is an oral cancer drug on the market and it's an alternative for an infused therapy or an injectable therapy, you cannot differentiate the cost sharing between the two. Now, that doesn't sound that terrible until you realize that that oral drug is typically 10 to 1,000 times more expensive than the infused therapy. So this is part of the effort to drive use to the more expensive drugs and impair the ability of the payers and the providers to manage the therapy in a way to be as efficient as possible. And that has the effect of escalating the drug costs. And then finally, there's two more things. The Affordable Care Act came in, put additional rules, kind of pulled a lot of those Part D rules over into the commercial market. It's many great things happened there, but it didn't do anything to empower the purchasing side to be able to negotiate better with the drug industry on the drugs that have to be provided. And in fact, it's created an additional avenue for advocacy to restrict third-party payers from being able to take actions that will use market tools to drive costs lower. And then the real reason we're all here is because Gilead introduced sofosbuvir to the market, and that got everybody's attention again. So that's why we're here. So I'm really glad that that all worked out. I have a bunch of slides here about sofosbuvir because they're fun to have and to talk about. One of the things that's just remarkable has been that this market situation has led to an outcome of a market in which it is possible for a manufacturer to recoup its entire very large investment in a piece of intellectual property in less than 1 year. I just think that's a shocking fact. And we can talk a little bit about how that is in this particular case, just the basic numbers behind this are kind of mind-blowing. If you think about the question of Harvoni and the hepatitis C drugs, this is a therapy that works. This is a great therapy. We would like to deploy it as rapidly as possible to treat people who have hepatitis C. Historically, people who have suffered from hepatitis C, because the therapies were so onerous, the older therapies, which included the use of interferon, were so onerous that doctors and patients would wait until it was clear that there was serious liver disease beginning to happen in a patient. And at that point, you would start treating the patient for the hepatitis C. Now, those drugs were also very expensive, but you were ultimately treating a relatively small fraction of the patients who were ultimately suffering from hepatitis C. Now you have a situation where the drug is good and the side effects are so light that it is actually plausible that if you organized yourself the right way as a delivery system, you could treat everybody who has this disease. Indeed, you could look at this as a public health problem. Hepatitis C is an infectious disease. You could make the argument that we should try to get out there and eradicate this virus from the population. It just so happens that a lot of this population, the disease is harbored inside patients who you know where they are. A very large portion of hepatitis C patients are incarcerated. So you can actually go find these people and treat them. But it's, even organizations like ours have a very large number of patients. And we plan eventually to figure out how to treat them. Now, the problem is the price. Now, we can't say what discount we have on this. We're contractually prohibited from doing that. But we do know what Gilead has reported in its SEC filings that reported in the New York Times. And, it's like half off, basically 46% discount. So if you assume it costs $50,000 to treat one of these patients with one of these drugs, and if you assume that we've got about, I actually think we have more than 100,000 patients, we've got a couple of different numbers internally, we already have diagnosed 51,000 patients within our 10 million member population. The cost of that is $5 billion, which is, that's a total of $5 billion. Now, to put that in perspective, our total outpatient drug spending in any 1 year is about $4 billion. So that's one product, it's one drug, is more than an entire year's use of all pharmaceuticals. It's out of whack. And so the situation here is problematic because the drug is priced like we're going to continue to only serve 5% of the population who needs treatment with a pharmaceutical therapy. And instead, it's possible to treat 100%. As I told our friends at Gilead when I met with them, I said, your price is off by an order of magnitude. There is one too many zeros in the price of your drug. You know, and what's interesting about that, though, is, I don't know if I can go back one. I shouldn't have gone there. Yeah, so what's interesting about that is the current dialogue has been since the new therapy from AbbVie has come onto the market, we went from having this list price of $80,000 or $90,000, and suddenly there are discounts being offered down to this level, so now it's maybe $50,000 is what it costs. And what you hear a lot of people say is, hey, the market is working, competition is working, that's fantastic. My reaction to that was, well, if it was 10 times too expensive before, now it's still 5 times too expensive. So, you know, I think what happened was they figured this price just happens to be about what the European price is, and they probably figured that's about what we think we're going to have to justify selling it to Medicaid for, so that's what we're going to be able to sell it for anybody who's able to actually make the market work. So it's a very perverse situation, but it's excellent at highlighting what I think can happen if players are really taking the situation that exists, fully leveraging the upside that they have in terms of pricing. I really do think that what's happened here, and the thing that's more disturbing about this, frankly, this is just, it's different in other places, you know, other manufacturers are looking at what's transpiring with the hepatitis C drugs, and they're realizing that, we don't know that we've hit the upper limit yet on where we should set the launch prices for these drugs. You know, it's ultimately, and it is interesting because it is ultimately a political process. The market does not work to set launch prices of drugs. There's nothing about it. It's not a negotiated process. There's nobody has any influence over it. It truly, in fact, at the Princeton conference this week, where a number of us attended, one of my old colleagues in the drug industry, a guy named Richard Evans, who I think is the most thoughtful person explaining drug pricing. He used to work for Roche, and then he's just a really thoughtful consultant that tells the story very clearly about this. He said, you know, prices rise rapidly because they can. Constraints are almost non-existent in the U.S. market. I mean, this is what he said a couple of days ago, and it was, you know, you can put all the intelligent economic terms around it you want, but the truth is there's no constraint on where a manufacturer can set the price. The only constraint is a political constraint. That's the only constraint, is at what point will they get in trouble for setting the price too high? And that's why this debate is so important, because it's not clear to anybody, to the other manufacturers, to Gilead, that they've hit that point. We're complaining about it. We're all here because we're concerned about it. But ultimately, the question is, are policymakers, is there a plausible likelihood that policymakers will do anything about it? And that's really how they set the launch prices of these drugs. And that's why it's great that we're having this dialogue, including what maybe could policymakers do about some of this stuff. So I don't want to read slides, so you guys can read this slide. I do think there's a key problem with the policy discussion around drug costs and drug pricing is that insurance coverage winds up being the conversation that policymakers want to have. So my colleagues and I who work at the state level as well, we spend the vast majority of our time on prescription drug issues, not talking proactively about drug pricing and what can be done about drug pricing. We spend almost all of our time trying to defend drug benefits that are not 100% comprehensive, that have cost sharing, that are designed in a way to have, you know, to do step therapies, to try to use sensible first therapies before you move on to something else, that have coinsurance, which admittedly can be quite high now with the prices of these drugs. But that's the conversation that we wind up having at the policy level, at the state level. It's the insurance isn't comprehensive enough, not the underlying problem of what the prices are. So we really don't think the right answer is to withhold clinically appropriate treatments. We need to design solutions that accelerate access to clinically appropriate therapies, but at the same time, deal with the problem. You can't just say we're going to eliminate all cost sharing. That's just going to exacerbate the pricing problem. You're not going to research your way out of this problem, essentially, because I think everybody knows what the problem is. But it really is the question of pricing. And in the case of sofosbuvir, that price is the one thing that stands in the way of making sure that public programs, that the Medicaid programs, that the correction systems, and that public payers are able to actually deploy the drug in a way that serves everybody who can benefit from it. So these are the other questions that were set up. I think I've said all of this stuff in some respects. I mean, I do think we just need to be asking, you know, is drug pricing a public health problem or is it an insurance coverage problem? The question of value is very interesting, and I think we'll have some discussion about some of this as time goes on. I do think that Bernard's basically right. I think not only is it not tied to what it costs them to develop a drug, it's not very well tied to what the value of the drug is either. And we can talk about that a little bit more. And if it's going to be about value, Ted's coming to give me a hug, so I'm done. I'll wrap up in 1 minute before my hug. So, you know, it's who is going to decide the meaning of value and how it's defined, and there needs to be a more explicit conversation about that. Is it just the manufacturers? Is it researchers working for the manufacturers? Is it the payers? Is it researchers working for the payers? Or is this ultimately a societal question that we need to have open conversation about? And then I do think there's a question about whether there needs to be an open, engaged dialogue about intellectual property protection and its extent. And I don't have the answer to that, but I do think that there's a truth that if you even ask this question, you're shamed to say that you don't believe in innovation. And we have to get away from that. So, drug prices are increasing at an unsustainable rate. Market's been undermined for 3 decades. I'm glad we're all here to talk about it. And hopefully we'll come up with some solutions to the problem today. So thanks very much, everybody.